Renew Biopharma is a San Diego-based synthetic biology company focused on creating pure, uncontaminated, and non-psychoactive cannabinoids to enable human therapeutic breakthroughs and improve human health. The company relies on molecular biology and pathway engineering instead of using agriculturally grown cannabis plants. Renew Biopharma plans to develop therapies for chronic pain management, Huntington's disease, Parkinson's disease, and concussion therapy.
Joining me now is Mike Mendez. He's the CEO of Renew Biopharma. Mike, welcome.
Thanks. Great to be here in Toronto.
Yeah, you bet. What's the what are you biofarming?
Well, you know, it's big news on the streets. It's cannabinoids.
Right.
It's new molecules. It's kind of a new frontier.
Yeah.
People now are thinking about ways to make cannabinoids, make therapeutics,
THC,
make new molecules. Yeah.
CBD.
But all kind of maybe in a biotech play in terms that it's done through fermentation, so outside of the plant.
So this is one thing that I am curious about. Fermentation qualifies as bioengineering?
Yeah, it does in that sense. So it's controlled.
It's the same way we make alcohol, isn't it?
Yeah, it's true, but it's under kind of control. There's some control of it.
Right.
And I think that's kind of been maybe a real factor on focusing this, because one wants to make therapeutics, which is what Renew does. Our focus is really making therapeutics. And to do so, we need to do it in a controlled fashion.
So therapeutics are essentially pharmaceutical formulations using the key molecules, the key compounds from the different CBD array to target specific indications?
Yeah, actually even beyond that. So the plant makes a lot of natural cannabinoids, and there's a broad range of them, hundreds of them. But actually, you can make derivatives, even take those, move them beyond even that. You can actually modify them to actually be the real therapeutic value that you want. So it's an untapped area. This is an area that, scientists haven't looked at, and there's either legality issues, but also it couldn't be done outside of the plant. And so only recently, with the kind of the discovery of synthetic biology, along with the legality, has now allowed this new frontier, this new area to kind of emerge.
So Renew Biopharma, what is your approach within this biosynthetic space? We've got different chassis, as they call them, or
correct,
organisms on which to propagate or express cannabinoids. So some of the chassis are yeast, some are bacterial, some are algae, some are even methane. So what is your approach to this whole thing?
Well, you know, and again, in some ways, I guess we'll use the term, we're kind of chassis agnostic. It really doesn't matter which chassis we want to hook up. We're more interested which of these chassis make the molecules, the therapeutics that we want to make. We have focused heavily on microalgae because in a lot of ways, you've got to think of, you have a plant and you want to go put that system back into another plant. So it makes more sense to go from a cannabis plant into a microalgae, which is a plant.
Right.
So there's advantages.
Right. Where are you at with the whole evolution of this? Are you actually producing cannabinoids now on microalgae?
We are. Matter of fact, we've gone much further than that. We've already made derivatives. We've already have our first drug lead. We're focusing on traumatic brain injury, TBI. And the real factor for that, why we came into this space, is cannabinoids are privileged molecules. They get across the blood-brain barrier, as we all know. And that allows you for the first time to actually go after neuroinflammatory diseases, neurodegenerative diseases, and even make a TBI treatment. So TBI is a big deal in the States, and there is no way to solve that problem. But we think with cannabinoids, you're definitely going to have an advantage to go and treat TBI.
So how soon is it then till we see a Renew bioengineered traumatic brain injury product on the market?
So in some respects, if you're going to go down this direction, it has to be treated like a new drug. So probably in the next 3 years, we'll file our first IND. So you have to go through all the this is an FDA-approved drug. So it's going to, the IND will file it in 3 years, probably followed up by more clinical trials. There's going to be a lot of rigor involved. And only for that is because we want to make medical claims. So this isn't a nutraceutical, it's a therapeutic.
So would an analogous company be GW Pharma?
Yeah, so I think they've done such a great job in kind of pioneering the concept that you can find useful molecules out of the plant, right? And they're using it for epilepsy,
right?
Again, because they need to treat a brain injury in that case.
Right.
So it's the same play, and the only difference is that they're using whatever natural molecules that the plant makes. We use those natural molecules kind of as a direction to point to. So we use them, the framework of them, is like that's the direction to go, but we modify them to make them far more potent and have a far more druggability.
Wow. Okay. So tell me, it sounds like this is high science. It's beyond rocket science. It's real serious stuff. So tell me about your bench strength.
Well, you know, again, what you're seeing for this first time in this conference is there's a whole different, school of people now entering the space. There's a lot of myself, I've been in biotech for 30 years. I've been involved in a lot of startup companies. This is my 10th startup company. And you're seeing now, I think more of the biotech approach, which again entails raising a lot of money, hiring a lot of people, and there's a real drive toward it. I think, and it's a very different philosophy. You know, intellectual property comes to play, understanding your markets in terms of what therapies you're using. It's becoming a lot more sophisticated in that sense, and it's a new breed. I mean, you were at the conference. Mm-hmm. You saw the different players that were there.
Yep.
There were some, you know, fairly large companies, fairly small companies, a lot of innovation.
Yeah.
But it's an amazing time.
Sure. The takeaway for me from the conference was that it doesn't seem like the biosynthetic cannabinoids are going to threaten the cultivated cannabinoid industry anytime soon.
Yeah, I would agree with that. And again, you know, we're talking in terms of timelines, right? I think that there's a group of people you saw at the conference were very focused on trying to make large-scale production.
Mm-hmm.
So I think their focus, and I think maybe their timelines are 3 to 4 years before they're able to make large-scale production and get it down to the price metrics that the customer wants.
Right.
And that's a completely different timeline than maybe a company like Renew, which is developing drugs.
Okay, right. Interesting. So then what made you choose traumatic brain injury as your leading drug?
You know, a big driver, again, was the fact that when you look at treatments for TBI, or even treatments for neurodegenerative diseases in general, most companies in the U.S., most large pharmaceutical companies have failed. They just can't get the molecule across the blood-brain barrier to make the treatments, so it's an unmet need. So we felt this was a great advantage by using these molecules, and by doing so, we have a leg up.
Hmm.
So, and we do have a leg up.
Wow. So it's almost like the ability of the science to treat traumatic brain injury could not advance until a molecule like cannabinoids came along to transport other compounds or modified compounds across the blood-brain barrier.
Oh, well said, well said. Exactly that. We wouldn't be able to do this kind of science if the legality issues in California weren't lifted in their frame. Once they were lifted, it allowed us to raise money, it allowed us to go after these molecules. But until then, all those treatments and all those molecules were held hostage.
Mm-hmm. Okay.
So that has made the biggest change. From that perspective, it has kind of freed us to now go after things that no one had ever been able to go out before. And we feel pretty confident there's going to be a TBI treatment in there.
Sure. My audience is almost 100% investors. So my next question is, how does the retail investor access a participation in this at this point? Or if not now, then when? And also, how do the institutions get involved now? If not now, when?
Well, I mean, I think you saw a little bit at that conference. So you saw all forms of life there. You had people who either have invested heavily in cannabis, the growing of cannabis, who want now to come back and double down. They want to have capability to go both directions.
Mm-hmm.
We have investors who are only interested in the therapeutics, so they only want to invest in the therapeutics.
Right.
And you see all types of investors, people who are interested in a seed round. They just want to come in on a seed. And some of the companies ourselves, we still have a seed round open. And then we're raising, everyone there at the conference is raising money. So they're in their first A round or B round is raising money. So now the time is, if you want to invest, now's the time.
Okay,
now's
send me subs.
Okay. It's all good.
That was easy.
Yeah, yeah.
Great. So then it's a long evolutionary pathway. So obviously as an investor, even at the seed stage, you're going to want to have a long time horizon to realize the fullness of your investment. So this investment obviously isn't for everybody. Day traders come to mind.
Yeah, absolutely. Yeah, there's a lot of risk involved, as you say. It's a long-term play.
And the other aspect that attracts me to this space, though, was that so even yesterday there were 12 companies out of a known total of 20 companies in the world pursuing this.
Mm-hmm.
And I thought, well, that's going to be a very crowded space soon. But then after listening to all of the speakers at the conference, I realized, well, it's not going to really be that crowded that quickly because it takes such a merger of scientific disciplines to come together under one particular management scheme and direction with an outcome in common that it's not the kind of thing where you could say, you know what, let's go start a mine or drill an oil well or grow a crop. You gotta invest a lot in the assembly of the manpower. So that was a bit of a relief. But then, should this be viewed by the investor as a longer term biotech play then?
I think you have both setups. I think if you want to invest in Renew, it's a long-term play and it's a more risky play because we're developing therapeutics. And some people, that's exactly, they're okay with the multiples because you're going to get that fairly large multiple on a drug, but it's going to take longer term and it's going to take more investment. Mm-hmm. So there are investors who are okay with that. Mm-hmm. Now, on the flip end, if that's not your cup of tea, then more than likely you would invest in companies that want to make more of a commodity. Whereas right. I think you could get a potential return in 2 to 3 years mm-hmm. From that. So I think where do you want to play and how you judge your risk?
Sure.
You know, and because there is risk. And I'd right. say Renew in some respects has some of the greatest risks in terms of long-term play, but has the greatest payout
right.
in terms of multiples.
Perfect. All right, Mike, we're going to leave it there for now. That's a fascinating sure. story. We'll come back to you in due course next time you're in town.
Great.
Stop by.
And, is that a promise?
That's a promise. Thank
right.
you for joining us today.
Yeah, thank you so much.